It's okay. I just gave right here.
It's okay. Okay.
Thank you.
It was much more detailed, and I really.
Yeah, he's fantastic.
Well, thank you.
Appreciate it.
Pleased just to like get like those details from the lawyers and stuff.
Right.
And
right. That's awesome.
Microphone first one, can you move a little bit toward this one? Yeah. Thank you. I give you ice cream when I get raised. Yeah, the first one on the left, just turn it. Very good, thank you.
Thank you. On record, this is case number 17-CR-001245, State of Ohio versus Timothy S. Schmidt. Mr. Schmidt is in court, represented by counsel, Attorney Edward LaRue. Representing the State of Ohio, our assistant prosecuting attorneys, Karen Kowal, the chief, and Jacqueline O'Donnell. The defendant was last here on March 19, 2018. He pled guilty to count 3, felonious assault, peace officer victim. A felony of the first degree with a 7-year firearm specification. Count 4, felonious assault with a peace officer victim. Felony 1 with a 7-year firearm specification. And count 7, resisting arrest. Felony 4 with a 1-year firearm specification and a 7-year firearm specification. Told the parties that counts 1, 2, 5, and 6 will be dismissed upon completion of sentencing. So I referred the defendant for a pre-sentence investigation and report and set sentencing for today. I have received a pre-sentence report prepared by the Lake County Adult Probation Department dated April 11th, 2018. I have received a comprehensive psychological evaluation prepared by Dr. Rinsberg of the Adult Probation Department dated April 18, 2018. I have received victim impact statements from both officers, Planasek and Anderson. I have received an impact statement on behalf of Mrs. Planasek, and I have also received a letter from the defendant's father, as well as sentencing memorandum from the defendant on April 19th, and from the state filed yesterday. I have read all of these documents. I will make them all part of the record. Are there any inaccuracies or any modifications needed to the pre-sentence documents, Mr. LaRue?
Your Honor, not that I'm aware.
Is there any reason not to proceed to sentencing at this time?
No, Your Honor, I don't think so.
You can stay up if you want. I can be backwards. You can stay seated if you want. Your choice. You may address the court first.
Thank you.
Your Honor, the easiest and most popular way to resolve the issue of sentencing Mr. Schmidt would be to satisfy an obvious and understandable hunger for revenge for Mr. Schmidt's actions and the pain that he's caused many of the assembled here today, and give Mr. Schmidt essentially the closest thing to a death sentence allowed by law. However, the arguments that the state makes in its sentencing memorandum as to Mr. Schmidt's perceived intention to purposely take the lives of these two officers are unfounded, given the state's agreement to dismiss counts 1 and 2 of attempted murder, and as the video of the incident itself clearly proves. To ask this court to conflate dismissed charges and to sentence for these dismissed charges with those charges Mr. Schmidt has actually entered pleas to and is here for sentencing today would be improper under the law and is simply incorrect as a matter of fact. Further, such an effective life sentence for the charges to which Mr. Schmidt has pled guilty would not prevent such an instantaneous and instinctually driven crime like the one here in this case in the future, nor would it send a message to other possible future criminals who might respond to this incident as Mr. Schmidt did while suffering from a chemical addiction. It will, however, send a message that if you have a medically and legally recognized disease known by doctors, mental health professionals, and the like as an addiction or chemical dependency, you will be punished here in the same way as if you were a purposeful, methodical, attempted assassin. Now, the common response I hear in such a situation as this, in the position I am in as a criminal defense lawyer, is that Mr. Schmidt didn't consider the victims and their pain when he committed these crimes. Why should we consider treating him any more fairly than he did his victims? Your Honor, I offer that by adherence to this Old Testament eye for an eye, tooth for a tooth code of justice, we prove ourselves only mere animals, rejecting Christian morals and values upon which we built our country long after the Old Testament was the favorite scripture guiding society's actions in meting out punishment for crimes. We, in effect, would be preferring the approach of groups like ISIS and the Taliban instead of those devised by the great Greek and Roman legal philosophers, thereafter informed by Christian ethics and morals, that has been the basis of our own legal tradition in America for more than 200 years. It is us to be better than the revenge at all costs mentality, better than raw emotion and the psychology of the mob, and to treat Mr. Schmidt as we would wish to be treated if we somehow were in his place. A man who did a terrible thing, but who is contrite, who has been suffering from a disease that largely drove his actions on September 28th, and who is a man just like anyone else, worthy of justice, leavened with mercy. After all, at least it's been my understanding and belief, based on my upbringing, as I'm guessing it has for many of us here, that we are all sinners, Judge. To do less than that and look at Mr. Schmidt in this context would be in conflict with the law and the application of common sense to this case, as I spelled out in our sentencing memorandum filed a week ago with this court. I would like to take a moment to highlight some of the undeniable truths about what happened in this horrific incident of September 28, 2017, that we believe are particularly pertinent to fashioning a sentence that satisfies and reflects the overriding purposes of sentencing as set forth in Ohio Revised Code 29-29-11. First, to protect the public from future crime by the offender and others. And secondly, to punish the offender using the minimum sanctions that the court determines accomplish those purposes without imposing an unnecessary burden on the state or local government resources. Applying these purposes as the law requires in felony sentencing of a criminal defendant, there can be no question that a low end of the sentencing range of a sentence of 20 years or more would largely prevent concerns of possible future crimes committed by Mr. Schmidt, not just because he'd be in his mid-50s by the time of his release, but because that length of a sentence, with its sobriety necessitated by his imprisonment, would get to the heart of the reason for this and all his prior offenses of any import. In other words, having been sober for decades, Mr. Schmidt would not be a threat to commit future crimes, given his forced sobriety while in prison and his commitment to it, particularly given the many years following such a sentence where he would be monitored by the Adult Parole Authority and where he could face up to one half of his original sentence should he violate parole in any way. Additionally, as the court is aware, Mr. Schmidt continues to have medical issues, a colostomy bag, a urinary catheter that threatens his health, along with severe plaque psoriasis condition that is an autoimmune disease. So he too bears real life physical costs for his actions that will be an incapacitation for this offender for the rest of his life. As for punishing Mr. Schmidt, quote, using the minimum sanctions that the court determines accomplish those purposes of sentencing without imposing an unnecessary burden on state or local government resources, end quote, citing to 29-29-11. Again, clearly 20 years and more of enforced sobriety while serving a sentence, followed by many, many years of parole that he would face, and the threat of more prison time should he fail to maintain that sobriety, would clearly ensure a punishment of at least 30 or more years of combined prison and parole to protect the community well past Mr. Schmidt's 30th birthday, 60th birthday. Finally, such a punishment and sentence, while it will cost the state and local governments a little less than $50,000 to carry out, will be far less costly than the more than $1.1 million that a sentence the state would have you hand down will cost this community and the state. These are resources that could go to hiring more police officers, the prevention of future crime, hiring school teachers, better roads, etc. Now, while such costs are often dismissed by courts as being beyond the scope of their consideration in sentencing criminal defendants, the law specifically says that the court in felony sentencing, quote, shall be guided, end quote, by this mandate not to impose unnecessary burdens on state and local government resources, again citing the 29-29-11. Clearly, the sentence we move this honorable court to impose is in accord with Ohio law in this overriding purpose of felony sentencing, while the state's request for a maximum term fails to consider this overriding purpose at all, except to argue, well, it's worth it, without further discussion in its sentencing memorandum. It has long been argued that, quote, the true measure of our character as a society is how we treat the poor, the disfavored, the accused, the incarcerated, and the condemned. Your Honor, each of us is more than the worst thing we've ever done. And while Mr. Schmidt has been guilty of committing crimes to which he pled guilty without challenge, he's also expressed himself in ways that show a shocking lack of appreciation for the gravity of his crimes at times. A fact that the state fixes on in reference to a YouTube video interview of Mr. Schmidt in their sentencing memorandum. And I believe there will be a presentation of some of that. I submit to the court that in more than 30 meetings with Mr. Schmidt and representing him, I can tell you that his personal apologies to Detective Parmerger and others throughout his convalescence also speaks to his true remorse and contrition, just as honestly as any sense of rebelliousness and insensitivity he displayed in that YouTube interview the state asked the court to be swayed by. These apologies by Mr. Schmidt, Detective Parmerger, and others are also documented in the state's evidence it provided us in discovery, along with this YouTube interview. In closing, I ask this honorable court to consider Mr. Schmidt's statement he offers to this court on his behalf, which he wrote after long consideration of all that led up to his actions on the afternoon of September 28, 2017, that he speaks to his commission of the crimes before this court for which he's being sentenced today, and upon contemplation of how he can ensure that no such incident ever occurs again, based upon the critical threshold issue of his maintaining his sobriety upon his release, an effort that has been so hard for so many across this country to maintain over the years, particularly in this current opioid crisis. Thank you, Your Honor.
Do you have any witnesses presented?
No, Your Honor.
Timothy Schmidt, the law allows you to say whatever it is you want me to consider before I sentence you. What do you want me to know?
Your Honor, there are no words that I can say to officers. Plain and second, you understand that I can make right what I've done wrong to them in the community. Nor can I possibly say anything to heal the physical and emotional wounds I caused them by my actions, but please know that I am remorseful. I can only try to explain a little about why it happened, and I know that such an incident will never occur again, no matter the outcome. I wish to offer a bit of my story to explain, but not to excuse my actions that afternoon. For as long as I can remember, I've always been a guy who never phone. They're questioning me about my name, date of birth, etc. I told them the truth, panicking, and knowing that the warrants were probably still out there from at least one court. When I overheard the dispatcher indicate there was a valid warrant for me, I tried to slip away as if the officers wouldn't see me make my escape. As they recognized I was preparing to make a run for it, their anxieties to stop me increased, which in turn caused me to be even more spooked. I realized if I were locked up that I'd be destined to hell in some crappy jail by dealers who would not appreciate the danger of my going without the heroin and Xanax I had grown to depend on. I also knew such a withdrawal could kill me if I quit without being weaned off these drugs. And I so attempted to outrun them, and upon them putting hands on me to arrest me, I acted like a cornered animal and responded the only way I could imagine would allow me to continue to feed my habit and not risk a complete withdrawal and perhaps even death. I shot wildly and without provocation to attempt to shed my captors, but this is what the dope sick mind compelled me to do that afternoon. I cannot tell you and your families how sorry I am that I ever started using it, but I'm certainly a poster boy for the worst of what can happen once you do. I hope someday I can help others to avoid falling for this horrible, awful life, destroying drugs and having gotten sober. The loss of control over myself and the inability to be in control scares me like no other feel, given what I've done here. I only wish I could do more to make this right for all I've heard. Thank you.
May we see? Here from the state, Ms. Coleman.
Thank you, Judge. We do have several exhibits we would like to offer to the court before addressing the arguments regarding the appropriate sentence in this matter. The exhibits are necessary in this case because of the characterization of the defendant that he was shooting wildly in an effort to avoid being arrested in this case. I think the video evidence that we would like to present to the court at this time will show just the opposite. This was not an effort on the part of the defendant to shoot wildly in an effort to try and avoid being arrested. At the time when he elected to pull a weapon from the back of his waistband, the defendant made volitional actions to place the weapon in a manner that he could use it to fire directly at his officers. It's the state's contention, I believe, that after you view this video, you will conclude as well as we do that this was an effort on the part of the defendant to shoot and kill these officers, not to certainly try and just get away. Defense points out that in this case, we have permitted the defendant to plead guilty to charges of felonious assault as opposed to the attempted murder charges that the defendant is charged with. Oddly enough, under the laws of the state of Ohio, the charge of felonious assault, if shooting at a police officer, is a mandatory prison term as opposed to the attempted murder. They are the same degree of offense. It doesn't change the facts of this case at all. The reason the state insisted to a plea in this case to those charges was for that sentencing advantage, not because we contended that the defendant's actions were anything other than attempting to kill those two officers. With those comments in mind, Your Honor, we would like at this time to present the video evidence in this case. The first piece of evidence we'd like to play is from the dash cam video of patrolling Corey Planicek. And as a matter of background, when Officer Planicek was responding to this call, it was just an ordinary call, disgruntled customer at the BMW dealership in Louis Hills. Friday afternoon, beautiful day, just a typical day. Respond to a location, talk to the customer, tell them to leave. What you're going to see is that, fortunately for the state of Ohio, that Officer Planicek, when he responded to that location, left his dash cam video active at the time of this incident. Just kind of an odd thing that happened, not with any specific intentions. But fortunately, it catches this crime that happened at this time. We'd like to play that, but in addition, after viewing that, BCI was called out to this crime scene by the Louis Hills Police Department. They also analyzed that crime scene. We'd like to present the testimony of investigator Chuck Moran to explain in detail what that video evidence shows and what it tells us about the defense actions at the time. All
right. And so the video shows the actual assault?
It does, Your Honor. So initially from the dash cam video, the second video segment we will see will include the dash cam video, but also a video from inside the dealership. It shows the initial interactions with the defendant and the officers in this case. It's very brief in that characterization, but what you notice is that the defendant is very calm. The officers are very calm with him. They're talking.
an outstanding warrant. You will see the defendant initially take steps to flee. The officers pursue him, make contact with him, and then we'll see what happens. Other important note also, Your Honor, is the end of this segment of the video, if you want to show the officer's actions in relation to this. important note is the fact that not only were these officers subject to physical harm by this defendant, there were numerous patrons and employees of the dealership there. You're going to see these people come and rush the aid of these officers after the shooting.
Should anyone not want to see the videos, you can exit now.
Yeah. investigator Brandon comes to step up.
And is this exhibit two?
This is part of, state's exhibit one, you're on.
Still part of one.
Good afternoon, officer. Please just put rather state your name for us.
Yes, my name is Charles Moran.
And you are employed by UCF?
Yes, ma'am.
Explain first what your duties are, just briefly to explain your role in UCF.
So I'm a special agent with the Special Investigations Unit for Northeast Ohio, and one of our responsibilities is to conduct officer involved shooting and other violent crime investigations.
Now, in this case, did you respond to the scene on September 28th of 2017 to this dealership?
Yes, ma'am, I did.
Now, in regards to the information you're going to give to the court at this time, so I'd like you to talk, explain to the court about the firearm used by the defendant in this case. Where that was located at the scene, and what you were able to learn about the functionability of that weapon, and in terms of its condition, in terms of how it was loaded at the time that it was used in the season.
Okay. We located a Smith & Wesson M&P model 9mm pistol. It was underneath the black SUV that was parked in the garage bay. It was in a condition where the slide was all the way back. Open and the magazine was empty at that point. It was still seated in the weapon, but there were no rounds located in the firearm.
So you described that the slide was open and that it was in a locked position. What does that indicate to you in terms of the operability of that gun?
It means that all of the projectiles and the bullets that are in the gun have been expended.
And that's what happens when the gun is empty of ammunition at that point?
Yes.
Now, in terms of the magazine that was contained in that weapon, can you describe to the court how many rounds that magazine holds?
That magazine holds 8 rounds, and then if you chamber a round in the firearm, that weapon can hold 9 rounds.
So let's describe, or in terms of your later investigation, how many rounds was it concluded the defendant fired in this?
9 rounds.
So in that regard, there was a full magazine with 8 rounds, and there was one chamber already in the weapon. And in terms of this weapon itself, could you determine how it was carried on the defendant when he was at the application?
Yes, at the scene we located a holster where the physical confrontation occurred, when the gunshots occurred. He was carrying it in the rear of his waistband, very likely with his holster.
Yeah, I can see if it was correct.
Yes, ma'am.
So, in addition, is there any type of staking on this weapon?
The Smith & Wesson is just the
district. Now, before we get on to look at the video, through your examination in the scene, were you able to ascertain how those weapons were fired and what the impacts with any objects in those areas occurred as a result of it?
We did locate 4 bullet impacts at the scene.
And when you say impacts, can you describe them for me? Can you add that terminology?
Just where the bullet travels after it's expended. Gun. We found one in the back of the bumper of the black SUV that was parked in the garage bay. We found one in the, when you look at the video, the left wall, approximately 3/4 of the way up, at an angle upward. And we found another bullet impact in Mr. Schmidt's vehicle to his front windshield. Actually, that traveled from the outside to inside of the front windshield. Also located another bullet impact on the classic BMW building, significant distance up, it broke in one of the windows that surrounded the front of the building.
And that window on the dealership that was broken, is that, were you able to conclude from the trajectory that that bullet impacted the window and that subsequently entered the inside of the defense?
The one of the rounds went into Mr. Schmidt's vehicle. I think his driver's side front door window was down and actually completely traveled through there and impacted the front windshield. And then I believe it's the 9th shot is the elevated shot to the top of the classic BMW.
Now, Agent Moran, from these impacts that we discovered in the scene itself and its what you can conclude regarding the defendant's use of that weapon, the firing of the weapon in relation to the criminal officers.
See an officer playing sex dash camera video. The pistol that Mr. Schmidt pulled out of his rear waistband is now fully out. It's in front of him. You can see officer playing sex with his chest to Mr. Schmidt's back. And officer playing sex attempting to grab his arms and his hands, potentially the weapon.
What's the size difference between officer playing sex and the defendant?
Mr. Schmidt is a couple inches taller than Officer Plansek. There's a movement that Mr. Schmidt makes to effectively extend the weapon away from Officer Plansek's reach at that time. That's how it ranks forward. Cleared the lower half. behalf of Officer Plansec, and Officer Schmidt, and Officer Anderson is actually standing over here on the last gun shower. So this this frame right here, two more gunshots that went off. This is actually the fourth gunshot that's identified. You can start to see the cloud of light colored smoke, which is the projectile being discharged from the firearm.
That was the last shot that you saw that over the defense body towards the other officer Anderson had walked.
That is correct. Something else to keep in mind. They initially started with Mr. Schmidt with his chest to the ground, and Officer Plansec with his chest to Mr. Schmidt's back in contact. Due to Mr. Schmidt's movements and some momentum, Mr. Schmidt was actually able to roll onto his back, even against some of the force that Officer Plansec was trying to apply to keep him face down. He was able to overcome that at that time.
So this is Officer Anderson, the jury fired this one?
Yes, it is.
And for the record, how many times did Officer Anderson give us the shooting fire?
He shot it. Something else that you can call it. When you notice that Officer Anderson, when he initially walked to the curb area and came back, during his travel to the curb and back, he is noticeably limping during that time. And then the other really thing that I want to point out is that Officer Plansec, even though he was struck, he continued to try to secure the Mr. Schmidt, and actually was able to reach back with his right hand and take control of the firearm during this encounter.
Yes,
correct.
From that point, can you describe just for the record, aside from the dealership itself, what else is in physical proximity to the dealership in terms of roadways and traffic?
The roadway there is the general vicinity, and then on Thompson Center Road, and then there's another car dealership that's next to it. I'm not sure if it's a licensed dealership or but it's close proximity. Then there's also a medical facility across Thompson Center Road.
From the using that weapon from that vantage point, would any of those rounds that they have traveled in the straight direction reach that street level?
Potentially, the one that impacted is the front windshield of his Mr. Schmidt's vehicle. If that was there, it's in the direction of Thompson Center Road and the other car dealership. So unknown where it actually could have ended up.
Thank you, officer. I have no further questions for you at this time. Just for the record as well, Officer, can you identify these next photographs? So they're part of State's Exhibit 1. Can you explain what we're looking at these pictures?
So this photograph here was taken by our crime scene agents, and this is the area where the encounter occurred. See in this photo, you can see the pistol that Mr. Schmidt possessed. You can see the spine is locked back in there. Obviously, suspect the blood stains on the concrete. And also, this is Officer Lane's second vest, where many of the customers and the employees came to render aid to the other officers that responded after to provide them.
Number of cases recovered at that scene and identified have as being fired by this weapon vehicles for the ordinary form of insurance.
Yes, our firearm section of our laboratory was able to microscopically compare the cartridge cases and confirm that they were fired against this weapon.
I have no questions. Can you answer? Services that he shot a couple of them, really indifference to the fact that he harmed two individuals with the intent to take their lives, and the fact that this is glorifying his actions by appearing in this news format, the desire that other people would see it. I think that's important to look at in terms of evaluating his actions and his representations to the court at this time regarding this for the most part.
Right. Oh, yeah, when I was on the third day, and when she put them out the other day, it's not about me.
much of it. Officers every day stop individuals in cars and
gun, and how often an officer stops a vehicle when somebody either has a gun on them, or there was a gun under the car accessible to the driver, and people don't shoot at those officers. It just doesn't happen, and it shouldn't happen. And in this case, there should be a lesson learned that if you harm a police officer, there's a serious consequence for that. To try to make the argument that this is the equivalent of a type of sentencing we receive for killing a police officer, it misses the point. The point is, the actions of the defendant in this state were purposely designed to try to kill these police officers. If it wasn't for the actions of the patrolman Planisat in terms of his ability to restrain the defendant's movements, to limit his range of motion, he would have done that. Certainly, in this case, based solely on the officer's heroic efforts at that crime scene, you know, restraining the defendant, attempting to get him to stop, you know, from killing anybody, that's the only reason that didn't happen. We saw clearly from what Investigator Rand described, the angle of those bullets, the fact that he emptied every single bullet that he had in his possession at that time in the proximity of these two officers is supportive of nothing else. And again, the YouTube video only shows just his indifference, the fact that it's all about him, it's all about how he got injured, the effect on his life, the fact he's going to have to go to jail for this, and the reference that he shot two of them. We're not talking about a video game, we're talking about real life here. He shot two police officers that were doing nothing more than carrying out their duties. Your Honor, in this case, we believe in it, first of all, for the record, these are mandatory prison terms. The charges the defendant pled guilty to carry with them a mandatory prison term, and each of those charges carry with them a mandatory 7-year firearm specification because of the fact the defendant used a deadly weapon and harmed two police officers. So the law recognizes the severe penalty for conduct. The fact that this is a 7-year firearm specification is special in the law, and the fact that this is a mandatory prison term is a recognition by the legislature that this kind of conduct has to be addressed very severely. Your Honor, in this case, when we have to look at all the sentencing factors, and one of the factors is to punish the defendant. But in addition to that, the other factor is to deter other people from committing crimes like this. And a message certainly should be sent. If you harm a police officer with a deadly weapon, there is a serious consequence for that behavior. In addressing these factors, Your Honor, the more serious factors is the fact that the defendant did cause serious physical and psychological harm to these two officers, and we have two separate victims. These officers are forever changed because of what they endured that day. They're going to always be looking over their shoulder, wondering when it's going to come from. And the fact that if something going to happen during the course of the day that's going to result in them having to fight for their life. It shouldn't happen. In this city, it certainly shouldn't happen under circumstances like this. Under the less serious factors, Your Honor, we apply no factors that are present for the court to consider. The defendant did not act under strong provocation. These officers did absolutely nothing to warrant this kind of treatment by the defendant. And we would argue there are not substantial grounds to mitigate the defendant's conduct. His decision to use drugs and his decision not to become dopesick when he gets arrested is not a reason to shoot police officers. You know, the jail is set up to deal with people like this. We get them in the jail every day. People that get in there, they go through withdrawal. The jail is set up to treat people that are incarcerated under circumstances just like the defendant faced. Under the recidivism factors being more likely, one of the considerations is whether or not the defendant is likely to commit future crimes. And certainly he has a minimal record compared to some people we see in this case. He does have one felony conviction. But outside of that, the convictions, Your Honor, is the fact that the defendant entered this dealership with a concealed weapon in violation of state law. He was under disability, and he knew that. He talks about it very freely. And the fact that he used marijuana, he talks about in his pre-sentence report that he cultivates marijuana, he manufactures hash, oil, and dabi, and he uses it on a regular basis. You know, those are certainly criminal acts under the state of Ohio. We believe that is very strongly supportive of the fact that the defendant is likely to commit future crimes. We would argue to the court the defendant does not have any genuine remorse. The fact that he refers to these officers in that statement as two of them is just highly offensive. These are two individuals. You shot at them. You hurt them. Tried to take their life. In addition, Your Honor, the state would argue under the recidivism being more likely, the fact that the defendant does have a pattern of drug use related to this offense per his own admission. He's been addicted to drugs for over 5 years and he has not sought out treatment. Regarding recidivism being less likely, we find no factors being present in this case. The question for the court's consideration is whether or not consecutive sentences are in order in this case, and we
required in this case. We feel that the harm in this case is so great or unusual that a single prison term would not reflect the seriousness of the defendant's conduct. And furthermore, we did want to point out to the court that the firearm specifications by statute, pursuant to 29, 29, 14B1F, the 7-year firearm specifications too by statute were required to be served consecutive. And pursuant to 29, 29, 14B1G, the court may impose the other firearm specifications to be consecutive, and we'd ask the court to do that as well. Your Honor, contrary to the defendant's representation, we do believe the resisting arrest is a separate offense. We believe it is a separate act of the defendant. We saw a video, his initial actions when he was grabbed by the officer, his efforts to struggle with the officer, and the fact that as a result of that, we believe there is a separate act of significance, that his conduct is separate and apart from the felonious assault. They had a separate animus, and that as a result of his use of the deadly weapon, he inflicted a separate harm on Officer Plansett, separate apart from the felonious assault shooting him, because as reflected in his victim impact statement and the police report in this case, Officer Plansett being in close proximity to the discharge of this weapon, he fired it 9 times close in proximity to the officer's head, that the officer suffered damage to his left ear, resulted in a hole in his left eardrum that subsequently presents still continual problems for this officer today. He had been affected his hearing for a period of time, and he still has problems with that today. And we believe that separate action, that separate physical harm on the part of the defendant, inflicted upon this officer, presents separate conduct, separate apart from the felonious assault, that does permit this court to impose the resisting arrest consecutive to the other two counts. Again, it's our position that we are not dealing with one act against one officer, we're dealing with an action against two separate officers, that the two counts of felonious assaults should be viewed separately based on the injuries received by the officer separately, that those counts should be imposed consecutive to each other, consecutive to the resisting arrest. And then in addition, Your Honor, in this case, based on the actions of the defendant, that if he was attempting, in our view, to kill these two officers, we believe that the maximum prison term as to each count is in order, and we'd ask the court to sentence the defendant to 44 years and 6 months in prison.
Any other witnesses?
We do not, Your Honor. Well, Your Honor, so any other victims that would like to speak last time? Your Honor, for the record, Patrolman Craig Anderson would like to speak.
Good afternoon.
Good afternoon, Your Honor.
And state your name for the record.
Officer Craig Anderson.
And what would you like me to know, sir?
The reason why we're here is this coward right here didn't want to go to jail for a lousy traffic ticket. He thought that the lives of two officers was worth him not going to jail. You have any idea what you did to me, to my partner, to my family, to his family, to our coworkers? I spent 4 months out of work. 4 months. He spent 5 months. Yo, let me tell you something. You see, I don't have a gun here right now. You know why? Because they thought it'd be a hazard. But you know what? I'm not like you. I am not like you one bit. I can control myself. You tried to kill me, you son of a bitch.
Officer, please stay at the lecture.
I'm sorry, Your Honor. You tried to kill me, and you tried to kill my partner over a lousy traffic. Your Honor, I was out of work for 4 months. My partner was out of work for 5 months. I spent 2 days in the ICU. Fortunately for me, workers' comp covered all the bills. But still some financial issues because I wasn't able to work my part-time job. I wasn't able to work side jobs.
Thank you.
Or C-H-E-R-Y-L for Cheryl. Last name is S-C-H-E-R-E-L. Sorry.
Your last name again?
S-C-H-E-R-E-L.
Okay. And your relationship here?
It's my brother-in-law.
Mr. Anderson?
Correct.
Mr. Anderson is your brother-in-law?
Yes. I consider him my brother. He's been in the family for over 20 years. I would like to say the event that happened did not just affect the police officers. It affected everybody, including the families that had to rush to the hospital because we weren't sure if he was alive or dead, both of them. I had people at work that were praying. I had my kids that were devastated. I had my youngest who, for the longest time, was terrified every time we would go out that she wouldn't see us again. She breaks down in school because she wants to beat up the bad guy that hurt Uncle Craig. It's stuff that should have never happened. It didn't just affect him not wanting to get arrested. The lack of respect for police officers is insane to me. I've got so much emotions going through me right now. Nobody should go through this. And police officers should be more respected.
Thank you. Any other witnesses?
Not at this time. Your Honor, regarding Truman, for the plaintiff's sake, he has submitted a victim and he has
stated that. Correct.
Just what he has to report to the jury.
And Mr. Plancy is saying right now
he's present. With his
friend.
And his parents.
You presented your work.
Yep.
And Mr. LaRue, do you have anything for you?
No.
I feel like that his lack of respect for officers and lack for a firearm are very alarming, because I'm going through classes to, I sat through class to learn gun etiquette and safety, and I learned a lot. And I feel like that a lot of stuff could have been avoided. And if he were to have taken something like this before, and I feel like his drug use is very alarming, because I've witnessed a lot of drug use in my life, and I feel that was very unnecessary, because you don't have to go through drug use to get help. There's always people to talk to. There's always places to go that can help you. And I feel like that it just wasn't right. The fact that he tried to kill my uncle and Corey is very uncalled for, because he's got to think of the families. If he were to put himself in their shoes, the fact that if someone else was firing at his him and his family, how would he think? How would he feel about it? It just baffles me. I don't understand why or how anybody could do this to anybody else. So that's all I have to say for now.
Yes.
The court has considered the record, the oral statements made, the victim impact statements, the pre-sentence report, the comprehensive psychological evaluation, my conference in chambers with counsel and probation, and the statements of the defendant and the defendant's counsel. The court has also considered the overriding purposes of felony sentencing pursuant to Revised Code 2929.11, which are to protect the public from future crime by this offender and others similarly minded, and to punish this offender using the minimum sanctions that the court determines accomplish the purposes without imposing an unnecessary burden on state or local governmental resources. I have considered the need for incapacitation, deterrence, rehabilitation, and restitution. I have considered the separate recommendations of the parties. I have reasonably calculated this sentence to achieve the two overriding purposes of felony sentencing and be commensurate with and not demeaning to the seriousness of this offender's conduct and its impact on the victims and on society, and to be consistent with sentences imposed for similar crimes committed by similar offenders. In using my discretion to determine the most effective way to comply with the purposes and principles of sentencing, I have considered all relevant factors, including the seriousness and the recidivism factors set forth in Revised Code 2929.12. In that regard, there are factors that make these offenses more serious. The defendant caused an extreme amount of physical harm to the officers as well as psychological harm. He has caused significant economic harm to the officers, even though there is workers' compensation and insurance coverage. As Officer Anderson said, there are side jobs that officers frequently take to make ends meet. He could not, and Officer Planisic could not attend to those. The offenses are more serious because this affects the entire community, not just the community of a city like Lordy Hills, but the whole Lake County community is affected by these crimes. In fact, most citizens would think if he would do this to two police officers, what chance is there for the rest of the people out there who are not police officers or who do not carry firearms? The harm here forever changed the lives of these officers, their families, co-workers, and the community. There are no factors making the offense less serious. There's no provocation whatsoever. There are no mitigatory grounds. The defendant was voluntarily under the influence of whatever he was under the influence of. In terms of recidivism, the defendant does have a previous criminal history. He is under disability, in fact, meaning he's not allowed to even possess a firearm because of his criminal history. And although it's not an extensive criminal history, as stated by the prosecuting attorney, he does have a 2005 conviction out of the Volusia County Sheriff's Office in Florida
intervention and then had to revoke it and then transferred supervision to Ohio. And in 2007, in Marion County, Common Police Court, he has a conviction for possession of LSD, felony 5. And in 2010, he has a possession of marijuana in the Lyndhurst Municipal Court. 2014, Garfield Heights, criminal damaging, disorderly conduct. That's one of the warrants that he had, another disorderly conduct out of Garfield Heights, another one of the warrants. And in fact, there were 5 warrants outstanding for the defendant for minor charges. There has been a rehabilitation failure, as I pointed out, with his interactions with the court, and yet he still continued to make a living with drugs. There are no factors making recidivism unlikely. By the way, in terms of making recidivism likely, the court finds that the defendant is not genuinely remorseful. There is a pattern of drug abuse here, and the offender refuses to obtain treatment. Court determines that the 1-year firearm specification on the disorderly conduct merges into the 7-year firearm specification, and therefore the court cannot impose a prison term on the 1-year firearm specification. And in fact, I will file a separate judgment entry specifically stating why, but under court imposes a prison term on 29.29.14.12, which is a 7-year, the court shall not impose a prison term on 29.29.141, which is the 1-year statute, firearm spec. So I think the statute is clear that only the 7-year firearm statute specification is permissible there. If the court imposes the 7-year, of course, the court has the option of imposing the 1-year and not the 7-year, but you can impose the 1-year if you impose the 7-year. The court also determines that under the 2 felony 1s, prison is mandatory because of the felony 1 assault on the police officers. So not only is prison mandatory here on firearm specs, but the 2 felony 1s. Prison is needed, though, to protect the public from future crime. A minimum sentence would mean the seriousness of this offender's conduct. So much harm has been done, so that a minimum sentence would be abhorrent. In fact, the court determines that the offender committed the worst form of these offenses. Although the felonious assault did not require a firearm, this was under the section where serious physical harm was caused. There's nothing about a firearm in that charge. He did use a firearm. He used a combat round, 9mm. He emptied the 9-shot semi-automatic pistol, and he emptied it within roughly 8 seconds or 7 seconds. He
caused extreme physical harm to the officers, as well as psychological harm and economic harm, as I said, to the officers, their co-workers, their families, the taxpayers, and the community, and forever changed their lives. This was a worst form of these offenses. The court also determines that the offender poses the greatest likelihood of recidivism. I'm appalled at the lawlessness in this individual. No driver's license. I'm assuming he drove. Tell me if I'm wrong. Did he drive the car to the dealership? He has no driver's license. He's under disability. He's not allowed to possess a firearm. He possessed a firearm. How did he obtain the gun? Did he go legally obtain this?
This gun was reported stolen from a burglary out of Kansas. I believe the year before this. It's unclear from the state's investigation how he acquired the gun when it was reported stolen.
Right. It was concealed in violation of law. He was voluntarily high on illegal drugs. He was escaping detention. He was avoiding five warrants. He fired rapidly. Based upon the evidence in front of the court, he makes his living off of illegal drugs because his last work, legitimately, was in 2012. The court believes that consecutive sentences are necessary to protect the public and punish this offender. Consecutive sentences would not be disproportionate to his conduct and the danger he poses. The harm here is so great or unusual that a single term does not adequately reflect the seriousness of his conduct, and his criminal history shows that consecutive terms are needed to protect the public from future crime. He engaged with these officers for several minutes before deciding to resist and shoot the officers. He struggled with the officers and resisted arrest even before he drew the firearm. Officer Plastic suffered harm outside of the projectile fired from the firearm when his eardrum was punctured, and all of those rounds were fired at the officers. Incapacitation, one of the purposes and principles of felony sentencing, is needed. Society must be protected. You only get one chance to make this kind of mistake. I don't care how law-abiding you've been, this one you only get to make once. It will never happen again. And you need to be made an example to society that you just cannot shoot firearms against police officers. This has to stop. You are very lucky that the officers did not die, or you'd be looking at a capital case. You're lucky that Officer Planasek held on to you as long as he did, and that Officer Anderson only had to put four bullets into your body before your left hand, your right hand, went up and say, okay, I've had enough. It is the sentence of this court that you serve a period of incarceration in state prison on count 3, felonious assault against Officer Planasek for 11 years, plus 7 years on the firearm specification. On count 4, the felonious assault against Roman Anderson for only 11 years. 7 years on the firearm specification. Courts ruled that the resisting arrest does not merge. And on count 7, the resisting arrest following the 18 months plus 7 years on the firearm specification. I would have given you that other 1 year that I said that the law doesn't allow. That's what the law says. The sentences are all consecutive. total of 21 years on the three firearm specifications, plus 22 years on counts 3 and 4, plus 18 months on count 7, totaling 43 years plus 18 months. I can't say 44 and a half years because certain crimes are prescribed by years and certain crimes are prescribed by months. So it's 43 years plus 18 months. You have credit for 164 days already served. The order will be all gun specs get served first. When you're done doing those, then it's followed by count 3, then by count 4, and then by count 7. Pursuant to 2929.18, the court determines that you have some probability of having funds in the future, and the court orders a fine of $5,000 on each of counts 3 and 4. The court declines to order restitution for lack of specificity on any amount, and workers' comp or any other medical provider can file civil lawsuit against you to recoup what they have. We're forfeit the firearms magazines. There was only one mag, or the firearm and the magazine.
There was actually two other mags that were in the contract.
Okay, so you'd forfeit all firearms, magazines, and ammunition. You'd pay the costs of confinement, prosecution, any supervision, any treatment, and court costs. On your release from prison, you will be on a period of mandatory, non-reducible post-release control for 5 years. The adult parole authority will give you rules. You violate their rules. They can return you to prison for up to 9 months for any one violation and up to one half the original prison term I gave you for all violations in the aggregate. All of that time is already part of the sentence. Should you violate post-release control by committing a new felony, the judge in a new felony case, in addition to sending you to prison on a new case, and sending you back to prison on this case for the greater of 1 year, or whatever length of time remains unexpired under mandatory non-reducible 5 years, post-release control. All of that time is part of the sentence. In a budget balancing measure, the state of Ohio put in 8% credit by engaging in programming. You may be able to earn some credit against time to be served by engaging in programming offered for that purpose. The credit does not apply to the mandatory 21 years of firearm specs. After you're done with that, then maybe you can engage in the programming to earn some credit. So long as you owe any fines or court costs to state and block your motor vehicle registration, the court imposes shock incarceration or any intensive prison program, bond if any is released. You're advised that during the mandatory prison time, none of that counts for any calculation for judicial release. Because I did give you a maximum consecutive sentence, you may want to appeal my sentence. You can file your notice of appeal in this court within 30 days of my journalizing of this entry. This entry will probably be journalized by Monday, so you can use that for calculating the time. And if Mr. LaRue would prefer, then I would appoint the public defender to handle any appeal. And if you were to ask for a bond for appeal, it would be denied. Is there anything further?
No,
the
State
Department.
So we ask that the court consider appointing a public defender, judge, or someone on the assignment list for now, not knowing the wishes of my client.
Public defender, I will be appointed in health services.
Thank you, Your Honor.
All right, we are adjourned.
All right.